Welcome back from that very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasajja. Today we are hosting Fiona Navasa Wall, the Uganda Law Society President, newly elect. Fiona, when we broke off, we were talking about professionalism and discipline in the society. But one of the other questions that then comes to mind is does the Law Council really have the capacity to hold members of the society to account?
It does. Well, they've been doing a really good job given what they have, but it's a very unfortunate thing that the Law Council is comprised of people that are employed elsewhere. It does not have the resources or the budget or even the legal framework to allow for the Law Council to exist on its own and pay salaries and have these people be full-time employees. Why? Because when you look at the amount of work that the Law, I'm also a member of the Law Council, when you look at the amount of work that the Law Council is given, and you have the Law Council chaired by a full-time justice of the Court of Appeal, and you have busy advocates being members, you have members of the judiciary who are actively involved, the other side as well, being members, that means that their output is going to be very limited. And that is why we have a case backlog of about 5 years. And this means that, imagine you've had an issue with your advocate and you take it to the Law Council and it takes 5 years. Honestly, when are you going to get your issue resolved? And if an advocate also needs his name cleared, maybe it was a frivolous case and it's going to take him 5 years to get this justice, is there justice? So in my opinion, the Law Council is doing their best, but until government makes it a fully constituted organ of government, then it's not going to actually be able to do its work as effectively as. So what the Law Society is doing is we're trying to filter, and we've also offered our mediation services, that just the way in civil court these cases are given for mediation, they can also give it to us, to give it to a panel of senior members of that society to mediate the cases that can be mediated, so that we take some of them out of the system.
Besides the Law Society coming in now as a member of the council,
I'm actually ex officio. I do not speak substantively for them.
Yeah, I'm not saying you're speaking substantively for them, but what I'm asking is that are there efforts being made on the side of government to ensure that the Law Council is a full?
I'm not aware of any such efforts. What I'm aware of is we are trying to work together with the Law Council to make sure that we see some amendments, some reforms that are proposed to government, to see how this can be done. It's in its early legs, so I do not have an update on that.
Probably we should use this opportunity for you to speak about what has increasingly become of concern to the public.
Yes.
Banks in connivance with some members of the bar and your society to grab people's property.
Well, I think for a long time people presumed that banks were, because you see, banks trade in trust.
Yeah.
We trust banks a lot,
yeah.
And especially international banks. We assume that somehow the international banks are more stable, they have high standards. So when they give you, and when you need money, you do not really read the small print. And a lot of people, a lot of Ugandans do not consult lawyers when they're borrowing money. But banks know the value of lending
someone money.
So banks always use lawyers. So the lawyer who's representing the bank is going to work in the bank's best interests. So if you know you are going to deal with a bank or with any institution about money for your company, for yourself, use a lawyer. Invest in a lawyer. That lawyer will work for you and will be able to show you the small print and warn you that there are time bombs here. There's a lot of things here. And they'll also look at the compliance aspect. Do not wait for when they're asking you for your money to say you know, you're taking my property. No, you need to understand, because when we are borrowing money, sometimes we just want to look at the money. That's all that matters. You will do anything. I've seen people who even forge bank statements and misrepresent themselves and say that every month I'll be able to give 10 million when you don't even have that income. Then after that, when they come for your property, you have an issue. So what I'd advise the public is that banks are always prepared for you. Banks get legal opinions, banks get tax opinions, banks get advisors from everywhere, insurers who to advise them. If the bank is telling you to sign up for an insurance policy, get an insurer to advise you, get an insurance broker to advise you, because your interests are at stake. And the way the bank cares about its interests is how you, as an ordinary citizen of this country, should care about your interests. So use your lawyers. Yesterday was Love a Lawyer Day. So it's high time that people embraced lawyers and use them not to cure problems, but to avoid them.
To avoid problems. Fiona, elections are here. But my concern is about electoral violence. What we saw in the party primaries across the country, a lot of fraud, a lot of violence, speaks of what is to come in January, February, when we go for
hopefully
the elections.
So
as a lawyer, what would you say can be done to ensure that during these electoral processes there is maximum protection of human rights?
I think, first of all, as a law society, we heavily condemn what we've been seeing, the election violence, the purveyors of this violence, be it civilians or security agents. We need to remember, first of all, that we are Ugandans. We need to remember that this country needs to be here when we are done with elections. We need to remember that we have families. We are from here. We are not going anywhere else. Right now, we've become the center of refugees because people cannot stay in their own countries. So we need to be very careful not to turn our country into something that will turn us into refugees elsewhere. We have a very tumultuous past, and it's very saddening when we see people acting like they've forgotten where we've come from and where we could easily go. We've seen this in neighboring countries. So for me, what I would say is we all have a duty. As the fourth estate, you have a duty to make sure that we hold everybody accountable, that we shine your light on the truth. And as the lawyers, we're going to stand and make sure that we have a system, that we are going to shine light, that we're going to speak truth to power, that we're going to speak truth to everybody, even the others that are not in power but might also be participating in this. But another thing that we're also going to do is we're going to defend those that need help. That's why we have that toll-free line of 0800 100 150. If your rights are being, during this time, spouses kill each other because they're differing in interests on candidates. If your husband or your wife is beating you because of who you want to vote for, please call us. If there are people that are threatening you in your community because of who maybe you stand for, or because someone signed posters on, please call us. We shall be there to help you and defend you. But the other thing I also want to call upon is the judiciary. We already have a lot of backlog, even with the electoral petitions. We are hoping that they're working out something right now as we speak to make sure that we do not go into, backlog of election petitions. Because you can understand the issues of justice around these things. And there's also the way these cases are prioritized, because you see some cases that arose in these primaries were being dealt with when they were older cases. So we need to see that that justice is served, that people are put in time, that cases are cause listed. But again, the same government that wants these cases to be dealt with and has created regulations to make sure that these cases are dealt with within 6 months has not fully constituted our judiciary. Mm. So staffing the judiciary right now is a serious priority.
It's a serious priority. I think one of the issues that then comes up is the lack of interest in public interest litigation. Mm. I'll give you an example. If there is a, when you look at, for example, the Public Order Management Act, we all know what it says. We know that the judiciary stand. There is even a ruling, the Mwanga Chivumbi case, for that matter. Mm. But it has been violated now and again. Mm. And it seems like you guys, the lawyers, are not really interested in ensuring that the law is applied.
We are interested. That's why applied. That case came forward. That's why lawyers went and represented it. But you see, if you create a, sometimes we are puzzled because if I go to court and get an order, and then that order is not respected by the security organs, then it's showing that I'm powerless. So we need the third arm of government, which is the judiciary, to be fully empowered. This is only the beginning. The passing of that bill was the beginning. It's now time to look at government and challenge them and say that, do you really have a will for us to have a true democracy? Because a true democracy has these pillars of government being equal. And this is reflected even in the distribution of resources. And we will have, because you can have so many court orders, but if you're not able to execute the judgments, if you're not able to hold anyone accountable based on those rulings, then they're toothless. And as lawyers, that's our only weapon, unless you want us to look at other weapons, but that is our only weapon. So as the Law Society, I think we've done our best. And up to now, we're actually prosecuting cases. We have a strategic litigation department right now that has about 6 cases that we're pursuing. But we need to see a greater willingness in enforcement of judgments, in respecting courts. I think you've seen sometimes organs that are disrespecting courts. So you've seen officials, public officials, ministers that disrespect court orders and disregard them with no consequence. So I think that we need to make our judiciary have more teeth.
Fiona, you know why I'm saying this? It's because in 2017 we in the Mama Mbabazi election petition, everyone looked at the Law Society as a society that was attempting to speak truth to power. Yes. And there were court orders that directives to government. And until when government came to a point when it felt that there should be electoral and constitutional amendments, as and when it deems fit and what it deems necessary, everyone was quiet, and yet you were party of
you went to court as I would say that's not fair. I personally participated in 3 statements that we released asking for constitutional reforms. We actually went on record and we gave deadlines, and one of the things we also gave was when they came up to the reforms, we gave statements on what we thought about those reforms. And we even had initiated a litigation on the matter. And one of the things you need to realize is that we cannot do this alone. Because if we're trying to get electoral reforms and want to go to court about it, and everybody is still scrambling to be elected in the same election you're saying is not. So it also takes the fire out of our wings. Mm. So one of the things I want to say is that it is not accurate that we were quiet. We are on record. If you look, you'll find that we are on record. We've had various meetings. Right now we're organizing an electoral colloquium that we're going to have on elections. And we have compiled a compendium of electoral petition decisions. And we want to actually do the colloquium to study these decisions and give recommendations to government going forward, some concrete propositions on what we need to do going forward. And we think that will set the tone for 2021.
Mm. Okay, we are here now, but the nominations are done. we have electoral reforms that do not meet what the judiciary really envisioned.
Yes.
You have some that are stuck there. Should we say Uganda is stuck, or are you positive that we can leap forward?
Again, this cannot be done by one institution. We need to make up our minds as Ugandans. You see, what happens with Uganda is we go into a coma after elections. Then 1 year before elections, everyone wakes up and starts coming up with all the rulings that have happened before and saying, now, you said you're going to do this, why don't you do this now? And I will even blame the fourth estate.
Yeah,
it's the same thing. Ugandans need to stop thinking in silos. We need to stop planning in silos. We need to stop thinking about tomorrow and tomorrow's bread. We need to think about the future. And that is why that conversation of electoral reforms only comes up during an election year. And we need to stop that. So that's why we have compiled this compendium of decisions. And that's why we're going to have this colloquium. And we're going to make recommendations. And I can assure you that our next 2 years will be about pursuing these electoral reforms coming into place. Because without that, then it speaks to the legitimacy of an election. But then you cannot question the legitimacy of an election where everyone has decided to participate despite the fact that the reforms were not done. So I feel that we shoot ourselves in the foot when we compromise. Yes, because even government has, the Electoral Commission itself has proposed reforms, but that before they even have time to, everybody's pressuring them to make sure that elections happen. So even with COVID, you saw what happened. I do not think that they're very well prepared to deal with COVID, but they've been forced to do things haphazardly despite their best efforts, because we are putting them on pressure.
Fiona, with that, we cannot continue this conversation, but we are grateful that you made it to the show.
Thank you very much.
Be sure to catch the checkpoint tomorrow, same time. Good night.